Welcome everyone. The topic for today is digital lending transformation themes and impact on operating models. We have seen that the digital lending business has actually in terms of democratized the credit that's actually available in the market. Lending used to be a business that used to take some time, and with the advent of technology, digital lending kind of completely changed the landscape, with access to credit no longer being as difficult as it once used to be. Obviously, with technology, there have been new operating models that have come about. The partnerships and alliances ecosystem that is facilitated as a result of the tie-ups with fintechs and the traditional BFSI players has resulted into altogether new opportunities. A couple of interesting points that have basically in terms of been happening from a digital lending standpoint has been the financial inclusion agenda has been achieved. Technology has been the greatest enabler. The partnership ecosystem is vibrant, and India is the largest fintech hub in the world next to US and UK. There is an enabling regulatory environment, and the future seems very bright. We have an esteemed panel which will actually offer perspectives and give insights in terms of what their views on digital lending are, which will help us understand and appreciate the themes better. Thank you. So the first question that we would basically in terms of like to put to the panel, and in fact, we have such an esteemed panel that their views and their understanding of the business, both the traditional and the technology-based enabling businesses today, the way they have straddled both the worlds, that's an interesting piece and perspectives that they can offer. And that's where I would like in terms of each one of the panel members to actually come in terms of what's their view on digital lending, in terms of how do their organizations view it, and how do they think technology has been a big enabler, and sharing their perspectives and thought on the same. I would just request each one of the speakers to kind of come forward and kind of share their thoughts on each one of them. There is no particular order in which in terms of go, but I would practically in terms of the way I see them on the screen, I'll kind of go in that order. So I see Mr. Krishnan Vishwanathan on my screen first. So I'll request Krishnan to go first.
Sure. First of all, thank you to ET. Thank you, Vivek, for having me in this panel. Really look forward to hearing from everyone else. It's definitely a panel of heavyweights. So I'm here as much to learn, as much to contribute to the discussion. Vivek, if I understand you correctly, the question you are posing is what do I understand as digital lending, and how has it that and technology enabled the way we've been doing lending in India for the last few years? It's a very, very broad question, Vivek, let me say, because there are so many facets of technology and digital. And I know there is a time limit, so for me to do justice would be tough. But if I were to just take a step back, right, I would say there are four themes that have fundamentally changed in how we think about digital lending in India, right? Point number one is just along with digital, I think the more important aspect is there are huge digital data rails that are getting created, right? The journey started with, of course, with the proliferation of 3G, 4G, and the smartphone era, but you know, the layers of data rails that are getting added, and most recently the account aggregator going live in India, is just fundamentally changing the extent of data information we have, from very structured, minuscule, to gazillion gigabytes of data and far more unstructured, right? So aspect number one is there is just a plethora of data that has become available at your doorstep, and therefore as an organization, if you choose to look away, you are basically not doing justice to what is the potential, true potential of digital, right? So that's point number one, data proliferation and unstructured data, and how does technology help you? I think point number two, which is, I would say, the low-hanging fruit of technology innovation, is historically there were so many manual process steps, right? And what technology has enabled us to do is take automation and digitization to a very, very different extent, right? And let me give you an example of, you know, the first credit card that I had applied for, and this was late 90s, early 2000s, I'm talking about, there would be a credit card form, right? I would either walk into a branch, or there would be, if I am lucky enough to be a well-paid salaried guy, there would be a relationship manager who will come and talk to me. He will explain. Typically, after I submit, I don't get a card. I wait for a week for the card to appear on my doorstep. And then, you know, there is always a step more to enable certain features like online banking, international, et cetera, et cetera. What we see is the degree of automation that has happened in digital lending has taken the customer experience and customer delight to a whole new different level altogether, right? And therefore, if today I need credit for something, whether it's consumption, business, production, I can get access to that credit literally in 5 minutes, right? And that's what all of the players in the market are aspiring to offer. So there is a degree of process automation that has fundamentally altered. And apart from customer experience, what it has done is taken the cost to serve these customers with credit to literally, I would say, 5% of what it used to be 10 years back. And therefore, what used to make sense, giving a personal loan of 1 lakh or 2 lakh, it actually makes sense to give a personal loan for 5, 10,000 rupees today, right? And the cost economics still makes sense. I think there is a third aspect of how technology has fundamentally altered and digital lending has taken the forefront is in terms of customization. Now, when we think about a customer, we don't bucket in terms of there are these three or four products. Here is my menu. Please take one of them. This is what applies to you. Today, when we look at a customer, every customer is unique. Every customer's credit needs are very unique. And let me give you an example. We have customers who are, you know, small entrepreneurs we cater to. They may be taking a credit for a, you know, 2 week inventory management. There are people who are taking, you know, a consumption loan which they want to pay off in the next pay cycle, right? So there are, the needs are very, very varied. And what technology has enabled us to do is understand, using that same data, understand the customer better, and therefore offer a one unique product to each customer. What it does is it puts a onus of complexity in the back end, but it takes the simplicity of what the customer needs right to the forefront. So the third aspect of how technology has fundamentally altered is in terms of customization and what you can offer to a customer versus another customer. So we're talking about micro segments and thousands of micro segments from maybe two or three segments. And I would say last but not the least, you know, all of this coming together, data from an analytics perspective, automation and customization has genuinely brought the Bharat, and I would say, you know, 30, 40, 50% of India into the credit mainstream. And if there is one thing that is different about India today versus the India 5 years back, today a customer who is, you know, early stage of his job or a small entrepreneur, he can genuinely get access to formal credit in a very, very hassle-free manner. So, you know, all of this coming together means that credit is genuinely more mainstream today than it used to be 5 years back.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Krish, for that. In terms of, you know, the 4 points on digital data, you know, manual processes being done away with. As a result of that, the cost of customer acquisition coming down, the whole customer experience and inclusive Bharat. Interesting pieces you brought in. Sumit, over to you in terms of your thoughts.
Sure. Thanks for inviting Vivek and ED. And I hope everyone is staying safe, got vaccinated at least once. Tough times are around us. I think the from a lending perspective, I believe the core remains the same. That look, just like how you have capital markets where any inefficiency disappears very quickly, I believe in lending it takes decades. And with the advent of technology, you are able to now exploit arbitrages, mispricings in the market and build a robust business model. I think the premise remains the same. It's just that technology has now allowed us to go after even thinner margin businesses where arbitrages are present. I mean, the core doesn't change. Core has not changed in 80s, 90s, and you know, even today. It necessarily remains the same that for a robust cash flow business on lending, you have to have an arbitrage and a defendable moat. Now, what I think technology is helping is from procuring capital supply to distribution and credit cost or customer acquisition, all four counts, you are able to create some arbitrage opportunity for yourself. Now, I think the lending business, depending upon whether you are a existing lender or a new incumbent, this arbitrage becomes even more important. If you are an existing lender, you have a cash flow, you know, then you take a synergy view on your core business and figure out how technology can help you unlock newer segment, expand your total addressable market size, or reduce your credit cost, thereby expanding your NIMs. So there are a bunch of initiatives which the technology in today's world has enabled. Now, this is the new decade where I believe that there are going to be innovative business models where you have one end, you have banks' deep balance sheet, and you figure out that how can you partner with them and operate in, at least in the beginning days, operate with them in a way where you don't actually compete, but you complement with each other. This is true for new businesses. With respect to this kind of segment, I can, you know, where actually we operate and we earn our bread and butter, is that the technology plays such a critical role, because in real time now you can talk to banking system, you can write data, post payments, read out information, read out their, you know, build a compliant technology platform which really allows the information freely getting access between customer, the technology platform, which is us, and banks. This capital supply ensures that even though a young incumbent is entering into the market, they don't necessarily have to operate at a very high cost structure from day one. Second, what technology also allows us to do, and I was just listening to your previous session here, that how branchless models are being considered by existing players and new startups like us. So the technology in our journey also plays a critical role in reducing that operational cost structure, where instead of building a big, huge fixed asset, we can work with existing offline assets of our lending partner, or for example, we work in gold loan, so we leverage storage facilities of CMS, Secure Value, and whatnot. So the real-time inventory monitoring, management, storage, all this is enabled by technology. So kind of operations cost is considerably decreased as percentage of AUM what it was in the previous model. And this really opens up the arbitrage opportunity with respect to unorganized market or NBFC shadow bank market, where we operate now at a lower cost of capital and lower cost structure. And needless to say that the initiatives such as aggregator NBFC licenses, and how you could now in real time underwrite loan for customers and build a credit history for them, so basically acquire through one hook and start offering them multiple asset classes, all this through one single app, gives a flexibility to gain wallet share without actually putting more and more human capital. So clearly, I think the core manifestation still remains very much, find an arbitrage, exploit an arbitrage, and build cash flows. In fact, interestingly, technology has actually allowed that the arbitrage opportunity available can be narrower and narrower. Earlier, back in the day when AAA, BBB, 80s, mid-80s, you had hardly any differentiation between a AAA and BBB. But that was a probably easy picking and, easy arbitrage to break. All the easy pickings are gone. I think technology allows us to go and, build businesses where even lower IRR exists, because you can be asset-light and ops-light model.
Thank you so much. In terms of an interesting perspective, Sumit, in terms of how exactly the operating model has basically in terms of reduced the barriers to entry by making operational costs low, and as a result of that, increasing competition and efficiency in the market thereby. Interesting. And thank you so much for that. Manish, in terms of your perspectives and thoughts, how do you see digital lending, especially, from a housing finance standpoint, what's your point of view, perspective?
Let me come at this, from a home lender, and more importantly, from a home buyer perspective. Just before that, thanks for having me. Great to be here. So a couple of points, given the time that we have. In general, right, the home buying journey, and specifically the home financing journey, has been built over the years around two assumptions. One, it is the most commoditized business, you know, in this whole space. What more is there other than just the cheapest lender? And the second, actually, which I think was a big challenge for us, you know, between COVID 1 and 2.0, is it's built around this assumption that the customer is willing and happy to meet multiple times. You know, why would there be a need to not meet multiple times? You go to see the house, you go once, you go a couple of times with your family, high involvement decisions. So there was never really a need, you know, for tech to play a role around eliminating some of these because it was based on these assumptions. So our perspective from, and let me try and bring this in via two examples. The opportunity and the, you know, the role tech has allowed startups like us to play. And let's take two examples, you know, in two areas that matter to the customer. One is from a product design perspective. A very large part of, you know, of home sales in India are under construction, where buyers have got to balance this whole total cost of ownership versus cash flows, especially at the time when I have as a customer two cash flows to take care of, right? My rent or EMI currently and the home that I'm buying. Now, if you overdo any one of them, if you pay the whole EMI, you have a cash flow problem. You pay absolutely nothing through your pre-possession period, it all gets loaded to a higher cost of possession. Now, what used to happen, at the time, you know, builder to builder, it would be, you know, deal by deal, you got to sit down and sort of design a payment plan. So we built and, you know, tech allowed us to build something called a design your own EMI program, which is basically take it up, lower it. We launched with a partner in Bangalore, like an under 4,000 rupees a month, you can own a home. And tech allowed us to basically take it to being, it's almost like an iPhone finance, right? 4,000, 3,500 rupees a month until you move into the home. You've balanced cost of ownership with what it costs you until you move in. After you move in, you can then service it like a regular EMI. Now, at the core of this is what this ability to customize on the system, take it up, take it down, and the customer can do it. It's not up to the developer and it doesn't need to be up to us as a finance. It's one example. Another example is, you know, when on the product delivery side of things. I mean, when COVID 1.0 happened, I guess all of us did reasonably well in adapting to working from home. It was only until this April and COVID 2.0 happened, where at least for, you know, someone like us, you realize that there is a difference between management and, you know, working from home and disbursing from home. These are two different things. And again, there was never a need for this earlier. Come April, we needed to do this. Now, you never needed to, you know, do this whole, you never needed to do a mortgage loan without meeting a person, but now you needed to. So platforms essentially, you know, and, you know, with help from companies like, Rajesh and, TU, is this ability to, you know, we can pull documents, you can underwrite, you can decide to do the loan. So you've got to go, we had to go, I beg your pardon, much beyond just sanctioning a loan. You've got to be able to underwrite, you've got to be able to get the agreement done digitally. So, you know, we had to learn how to, and thank, you know, partnerships, fintech partnerships came in, our own sort of pushing the envelope with digital at the core is essentially allowing you to sanction, book and disburse the loan digitally. Whatever documents can't be done digitally, a person shouldn't have to go. A courier should be able to do it. A third party agreement can be executed. You can find ways. Digital solutions are there for you. There is an ecosystem that's come up that allows you to do this. You know, to the extent, as an example, which is one of our favorites, is we had a customer work with one of these tech firms in Bangalore. They allowed them to work from anywhere, move to his hometown, and I think it was Udupi, if I'm not mistaken, didn't want to delay his home purchase. Homes being bought in Bangalore, lender, which is us, is in Bangalore, guy sitting in Udupi, gets underwritten online. We get the loan doc signed online, send one or two documents, we courier it to him, he couriers it back to us. And we paid the developer. The home sale went forward without the person ever coming back to, you know, his place of work. God knows when he will, right? Because his companies allowed him to work from home until 2022. But that didn't mean that the home purchase should stop. So here's a couple of examples that, you know, this whole transformation, clearly COVID's forced us to do this. I mean, you know, by ourselves, I'm not sure how soon we would have done this. But COVID, especially 2.0, forced us to do this. And we're really excited about the ecosystem that's come about, right? You want to be able to pull statements, and I'm looking forward with, you know, lots of enthusiasm to how we can tap into the AA platforms. But if so we get help to authenticate who are customers, you get help to pull financial statements, you get help to be able to digitize docs and, you know, what used to be sacrosanct, right? 50 signatures on a home loan document was a way of doing things. There's help available at hand if you're willing to challenge some of these notions. And from a buyer's point of view, it just takes, I mean, it brings the joy back into the home. Nobody really cares for the home loan for its own sake, right? And I speak for other forms of lending. It's what I can do with that money. In our case, for instance, it's stock. All I would really want to be focused on is make this home a reality, make it affordable, make it possible for me to buy, and just make it easy for me, help me be the bridge between where I currently live to where I want to go. Make it happen for me. And I think that we're very, very glad and we're very grateful to being able to tap into this ecosystem that's improving, you know, week on week.
Oh. Thanks so much, Manish, in terms of, you know, customer experience and operational efficiency in terms of the way the internal processes, leveraging technology and partnerships and applying that. That's been very interesting in terms of thoughts, in terms of, and that is, you know, truly in terms of how you kind of adapt to a completely different business model. Thank you so much for sharing that. Mr. Nath, I always refer to Mr. Nath as Mr. Nath Sir, because I had an opportunity of working with him in the past, and he has an institution builder, has built businesses in the past. And at a point in time when people would say that, I've built a business, let me do something else. He said that, you know, let me build a business again. Mr. Nath, your thoughts, your perspective.
Thank you, Vivek. Thanks, Economic Times, Grant Thornton, for inviting me. Vivek, in a way, you are saying you should have retired. But you did do that. I understand your point very well, but anyway, thanks. This is where I am. So I would start saying this, that think of, you know, if so young people don't read it, but if you read Hind Swaraj from Mahatma Gandhi, written by Mahatma Gandhi, or anyone of you who have watched Mahatma Gandhi as a movie, there was a thing called Oxford. So Mahatma Gandhi used to drive a Ford car, but he used to call it Oxford because at the front of the car, he had two oxen which were attached. Right? So you were sitting in a Ford, but the Ford was running like a bullock car because he said, India doesn't have fuel and all of that. All of these Maharajas used to come and gift him Ford car. He said, park it into the side, put two oxes in front of it and let, you know, we'll drive. So, you know, have both the benefit of being in a Ford car, but being driven by oxes. So the digital lending in India is at the same place. That we have the engine of Rolls-Royce. We have an infrastructure which is at a supersonic speed, but the front end of it, which is the provider of the capital and the and our embedded opinion about the lending is still in the ox era. Why I say that? Because eventually most of the innovation around lending is happening outside the banking per se. It's not the banks are not doing it, because banks have the power of the capital, they have power of everything. They're also doing it, but their large legacy businesses doesn't allow them to focus for future. They are all focused at the rear end. You know, they either managing their, you know, quarter on quarter growth, or they're managing their large legacy portfolio or so on and so forth. So it is, they don't have the bandwidth and time to create something for future. And this is just not in India, by the way, this is just globally, this has been proven. And majority of this, all of this creation, when, you know, I call it the tripod of the data, which is GST bank, especially for businesses like small business financing platform, which we are building. So So we are dependent on completely on tripod of data. So today we are, you know, disbursing more than 300 crore a month. We don't ask a single financial statement ever from a customer. Because we definitely we look at you know, the transaction history, we look at the banking history, and we look at the, you know, the bureau as for behavioral history, and everything get done from there. But finally, if you are not a bank, and even if you are a bank, the trust of people is with the bank, so money goes to them, and money has to come from them to people like us. Now this is the marriage of ox and fold, right? Because finally, where the control of capital is, unless the mindset changes there, how can you drive this? You know? So we have said that, you know, we have this mission of one taking 1% market share and 1 million customers by 2025. We will get this done, but we are getting it done because of power of capital, which I have been able to, you know, create for our vehicle. Because, you know, and it is odd actually, because I had the personal brand, the background, the track record, that I raised straight 1,000 crore of capital. Not that every fintech can do that. It's not possible, actually. And if that not be the case, innovation is not valued, right? So it becomes really difficult. And how this would change, I think so it would take time. So the simple reason for that is, if today I go, and I'll give you one contrasting example. So we have a multi-channel business. We do secured financing through branches. We do micro-secured financing through branches. We do ecosystem through supply chain. We do machinery. We do partnership and alliances. We do digital. Today, the portfolio performance of our pure play digital no-touch lending versus our secured against physical collateral of a residential house and commercial property is exactly the same. At the end of the day, customer, whether he's paying you, you know, whether he's giving you a property or whether he's not giving you a property, it's about his ability to pay back your loan. That doesn't get differentiated because he's given you the property. But if I today decides that 100% of my book growth should happen in a non-collateralized cash flow driven digital lending, I can guarantee you that all of the liability side, which we continue to get, you know, in bulk, right, would not come to us. So this is the ox part of it. Today, Ugrow has built co-lending partnership with some of the largest bank in the country, Bank of Baroda, SBI, and they have thousand crores of program. But beside the technology prowess we give, but it also come because we are seen as more safer lending institution. We may not be the case. I think so between us and a digital, you know, pure digital lender, you know, portfolio performance would be have a degree of 10% variation, but we are still seen, and that's why we try to marry, saying that when you are with the ox, behave like ox. When you're in the fold, behave like a fold. And that's why you run this parallel track. So that's first part of it. Second, but good part, there's other side of it, that the intent, all the entire lending fraternity is to adopt to digitization. So today, we did a pilot program called Pratham with Bank of Baroda. It's a 1,000 crore of co-lending program. A second largest public sector bank in the country has adopted our credit policy up to 2.5 crore of loan. We are disbursing live today without the financial statement, no balance sheet, no income tax return, nothing, right? It's purely driven out of GST banking and bureau. So I think so that is a change happening. Some people may find the speed of change to be slower. Some people will find it slower. I think you look at it in the context of 10 to 15 years when the transformation would happen. Purely from a small business financing perspective, the historical problem of the small businesses being completely informal, there is a force which is coming in. Formalization of economy through GST has happened, and the data of the GST and with account aggregation coming, the access to the banking data, and coupled with that, the bureau footprint, and multiplicity of this, what we call the India Stack 2.0 or the credit rail, would explode the credit. I'm only hopeful that, you know, there is no systematic event which destroy the trust of the lender who are adopting to digitization. That's my opening remark.
Thank you so much, Nath sir. In fact, the most interesting piece you touched about was the whole trust deficit. You know, when times are good, there is funds, there is money that flows in, but any systemic risk and there is an immediate trust deficit, you experience that kind of spirals into many unforeseen events. Thank you so much for that, Nath sir. Rajesh, over to you as you know, as a credit registry, as an extremely important key backbone to the entire ecosystem in terms of the kind of credit data that kind of becomes important, and increasingly the importance is only going to increase, and the database is going to kind of you know, for lack of a better word, explode. You know, with that whole, you know, your perspectives, thoughts on digital lending. Rajesh, you're on mute.
Thanks, Vivek. And I think Mr. Nath's point and your comment on trust was a fantastic opening for me, because our mission statement at CIBIL is that we think information is for good, and that good really is about creating the same trust that Mr. Nath and you alluded to as well, about creating that trust, right? And I think we are talking about the lending industry, and I've been a practitioner. I joined CIBIL last year, but before the 20 years, I was at HDFC Bank, and I was heading risk there on the retail lending side. And I would sum up a lot of what we're talking about as in that one sentence to say it is about trust. We can all lend money to each other any day if we know that you are the person in terms of identity. That's easier. And then the PD, the probability of default, that money will come back. Lending money is very easy if you have the assurance that it will come back. It really comes down to trust. So moving on with our theme for the day and taking advantage of that opening, I obviously, being the seventh guy to talk on the question, I have to be careful not to repeat and bore all of you and the audience. So I'll try and maneuver myself out of anything that's been spoken already. So pardon me if I am slightly clumsy or incoherent. I'll try my best. So I had really 4 points to talk about when we talk about digital lending and the disruption and the innovation, all that we keep talking about, and many of the things that the co-panelists brought out today. So I'm putting them into four buckets. So I'll take it first. The first bucket really is infrastructure. So all that we're talking about really comes down to the right infrastructure. We talk about OKIN from the iSpirit side, account aggregators, all that we've already spoken about. But let me take it a little further to say, all of what we are speaking about obviously depends on a very inclusive infrastructure where different components or different players in the ecosystem can come together and synergize. We spoke about strategic partnerships, alliances, all of that. All of that are not going to work if we don't have the right ecosystem, right? Obviously, account aggregators should help that a lot. Then coincidentally, Mr. Nath spoke about 1,000 crores capital. I think increasingly, when I think about this whole infrastructure piece, right? Lot of quicker, faster, and smaller co-lending models have to evolve. I'll speak about that in the second bucket that I've kind of written down for this conversation. So infrastructure may, account aggregators, co-lending, or this OKIN network that we're talking about, these will be very critical. Heavy duty collaboration and partnerships will be super critical, because between tech fans, fintechs, bureaus, all of us, if we don't come together now, we are going to worsen the industry with excess fragmentation. This is the time of some sort of coming together. I won't say consolidation, but coming together. Or we are going to fragment it so bad that I don't think we are going to have critical mass for a lot of the new startups, etc. So moving on quickly from infrastructure. Now let's talk about the lenders themselves. The lenders themselves, I think you look at large banks, and I come from there and I talk to them the whole day. Most CEOs tell me that their biggest fear really is, with all this changing ecosystem, how are they going to manage the strain on their IT architecture? How are they going to manage the strain? We came up with UPI, sure. A lot of volumes, some companies make money, some don't. But in the end, it is a heavy infrastructural requirement. I'm not a tech guy, but surely there have been a huge increase in transactions, etc. So banks are sitting there and worrying about where is this world going. They're bankers. They don't know technology as well as I guess some of you do. Then let's talk about fintechs. Fintechs, the good ones, have been raising their capital, etc., etc. But for fintechs, it is going to be challenging forever to not have a regular line of capital, which also takes care of their growth aspirations. It just can't be money that we raise in every series, etc., etc., or few lines with some banks. It has to be a superb model where this huge big ocean of large banks and these small little rivulets or rivers of these fintechs, who are, like we say in Hindi, it's time for that Sangam to happen. They're not two different worlds. They got to come together now, right? And these two coming together on top of that infrastructure I spoke about, absolutely important to get all of this together now. Because, okay, for a minute, if I were to be slightly critical or provocative, good 6-7 years back, I'm sure all of us have done enough presentations around the world about account aggregators, Jandan, Jamtunity. At least 6-7 years you've been doing this now. Are you really happy with where we are today? Not yet. Not yet, because I know it's all there, but it's not yet coming together because of these two points that I mentioned. This Sangam and then that collaboration, that infrastructure coming to it. It's too fragmented now. Moving to my third point. Oh, sorry, before that, the banks and fintechs, this coming together, more importantly, this coming together of these two guys on that superb infrastructure has to crash unit economics. A lot of these fintechs are not exactly doing weighted average tenor of 4.5 years of home loans like an HDFC Limited. ALCO challenges are completely different. ALM challenges are completely different in this business. So given the small ticket size, etc., unit economics have to crash. We can talk about different form factors between credit cards and BNPL, etc. You don't crash unit economics. It's a matter of time before the value proposition is lost or the market sees through that. Third bucket, consumers. Very obvious. I think consumers are borrowers in this case, very obvious as always. Attention span is getting lesser and lesser. I used to tell this to my board in my previous company. I say this even today. A lot of these businesses are eventually turning out to be the attention merchant business, which is what Google of the world is really. I think we are in the same business. If you're in a bank or if you're a fintech with a lovely app, it is totally about attention again, making the customer come there, hold his attention. How long can you hold attention? So attention span with borrowers is going to be lesser and lesser. With this kind of digitization, they have a wonderful way to compare the terms that they're getting. It's going to get much more competitive. Good for the consumer, therefore good for the country. But they're going to be able to compare, right? So competition obviously will increase thanks to the consumers pushing all of us. Flexibility. From the borrower side, flexibility. I've been a banker myself most of my life. I think it's quite silly that we only have 24 months, 12 months, 36 months. One day of the month you have to pay, blah, blah, blah. It's all too rigid and fixed for no rhyme or reason, not in today's world. It's not like in the olden days we kept one day for representation, because I've sat and done it as a kid. Millions of checks in the branch, you have to pull out those checks and then send them to the 400 different bank branches for clearing. So you did that. Why are we doing that today? So again, moving on in the interest of time, I think the fourth large block is regulation. I know all of us work closely with regulators, and I work very closely with RBI, SIDBI, MOSPI, NCGTC, all of them. And there's a lot of discussion these days about regulation. There are various committees I'm a part of, a lot of discussion. And the one point that I'm making is that, and not just in India, but also my other counterparts and our US office, regulations are something, particularly in this area, everything is to do with data. Regulation is very nascent and evolving. Every country is trying to figure out what they want to do with their own regulation. You come in too early, you're going to hurt innovation or disruption. You come in too late, there could be a SOX kind of a requirement instead of regular. We've all gone through history, right? So for regulators, it is a challenge. And obviously anywhere it comes to tech, right, it is going to take time for regulation to evolve. Why am I talking about that? When we talk about all that we are right now, how do we all factor for this evolving regulation? How is it going to alter our business strategies? How much do we go for regulatory arbitrage versus how much is it good to kind of be risk averse and hope for stability? Tough question on the regulation side, but I know all of you will agree with me that it is a huge differentiator in the way we make strategies. We talk more about approval ratios and business volumes, but we know that this is a huge enabler come regulator, obviously. So I think, Vivek, I'll probably stop here, probably taking my 4 minutes.
Well, thank you so much, Rajesh, for that. In fact, two of the things that you actually are the two questions additionally as well, what we have for the entire panel as well. You know, one's obviously in terms of from a regulatory perspective, as you mentioned, and that it's extremely important to provide an enabling environment there. And we do know that there is a working group that's being constituted to kind of look at the rules that need to be kind of defined for digital lending, from that perspective. So, the question more so to the panel around that is, you know, what would you think, you know, would be some initiatives, you know, through the regulator that could help the market in some way that you don't see today? And probably because there is some amount of uncertainty, it's a hindrance in some way. So what, you know, as a panel, any thoughts in terms of what are some of the initiatives that you would actually like to see from the regulators, government? I mean, not just singling the regulator, but also from the government. So any thoughts, you know, please feel free to kind of come in. I'm not calling anyone out here.
Can I go at this and then we can probably continue since I left it regulations. I didn't realize the next question is on. So then I can just continue. So on regulations, I think from our perspective, the way we are seeing it, that's again an ecosystem play. So what we're talking about to the regulators and the government departments, the relevant departments, is that eventually all of these ecosystem pieces, what are they really? We spoke about AA, account aggregators. We spoke about credit registry, public credit registry, PCRs, right? There are the credit bureaus. So how is the, what is going to be the underlying regulation, right, around this? We know we're talking about the privacy bill, right? There is the DEPA Act, right? So eventually what all of these have to do before I hand over to the next speaker is, between these three elements, you have the public credit registry, you have the credit bureaus, then you have some new sources of alternate data, say your GST, et cetera. They're not really alternate, but let's just use that because it's a new source of data. So these sources of data, new sources of data are going to flow through the AAs, but where we need regulation to enable really is, how is all of this data going to come together? Who all have access? We're all a little confused about different terminologies. Somebody says FIP, FIU. Somebody says specified users. There's a lot of confusion because in any world where there is innovation, right, everybody will give it its own nomenclature because that's how identities are created in the first place. And that's a lot of that is happening today. Every PowerPoint I see, we're talking about the same thing, but there are different definitions and different illustrations. And fintechs, I must compliment, they do a great job when it comes to marketing and presentation, at least much better than the boring bankers. So put all of this together, there is a lot of different possibilities of interpretations. What I'm expecting as regulations evolve is how they bring out the synergies between these different players or components of the ecosystem. A, synergies, B, definitions of access and control, obviously.
So interestingly, as I hear is, you know, you also mentioned in terms of, you know, that if collaboration is not really driven, then we risk a great amount of fragmentation within the ecosystem, which will be very counterproductive to what we are trying to achieve. And, you know, a regulator kind of guiding in the direction of collaboration. I do hear you, which is more in terms of when you kind of tell people, go ahead and collaborate and go ahead and share, then, you know, you at least see people being pushed. I mean, nudged is a softer word, but pushed in the right direction. You know, definitely hear you. Mr. Nath, any inputs on that?
Yeah, so I don't know, Vivek, whether it would fall in the realm of regulation or not. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I recently wrote an article on the 75th independence of the country, which I say vision for 100% access of credit at the 100th, and Independence Day anniversary. So it's called 100 on 100. As we all know that there is around $600 billion of reported credit gap for small businesses. India have roughly around 6.3 crores of small businesses employing around 11 crore people. And if India has to become an Atmanirbhar Bharat or where India has to succeed, that this 30% contribution to GDP has to go up to 45%. Employment has to grow from 11 crore to at least 25 crore. Because then only you'll be able to control the social unrest, which otherwise would happen in next 10 to 15 years. Because you have to employ people in tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns, rather than they keep moving to the Delhi, Bombay, and you see what happens when the pandemic happens. Now, how does that would happen? So I talked about it in my first opening speech. It's all about trust. And trust of both, the customer trust is with the banks. Bank don't have trust with the borrower, which is also a customer. So it's a chicken and egg situation. And I came up with this. So we, as you know, every time for at least for small businesses, when government comes up and say, I'm here to support, all the bankers start lending aggressively. When it comes to emergency credit line comes, you know, it gets full, more or less fully exhausted. When partial credit guarantee comes, you know, banks start acting. So I said, if that be the case, why can't, you know, we government look this as an economic activity? And especially the government, which is, you know, which is motivated by the vote bank. And if a 25 crore of employment is roughly around 40 crores vote bank into the country. So you can really take away all of the other problems which we exist. Think of it, I created is what I call a CDGS, credit, you know, credit guarantee through a digitally enhanced structure, right? With, you know, wherein I argued, I made this point that think of this, today is still roughly around, out of the 6.3 crore MSMEs, only 1.3 crore are on GST. So how do you motivate these MSMEs to become part of the formal economy? So if you create a guarantee structure by the government saying, if you demonstrate that from last year to next year, your contribution into the GST is increased or you have come there. If your GST turnover is 100, coming near to 100% in your banking, and this is the OK network and account aggregation can show that, that if your turnover is in GST and your turnover is reflective in your banking, government would give you guarantee from 75% to 100%. So if you are 100% in a formal economy and if you are 100% in formal banking, government would provide you 100% bank guarantee. Think of the economic loss which government can do. So if you take the increase of the GST revenue by bringing these population into GST, which is roughly around 18-odd%, and if you think the existing guarantee to be increased from 75 to 100, worst case, SMEs in India cannot make or create loss of more than 6 to 7, 8%. You know, this is the worst you think of. So on one side, you will earn, government would earn gross revenue on GST, which would be near to 18%, while it is only taking a loss of 8%. But it would just simply explode the credit to small businesses. So that's, I think, so is a thought. But obviously, you know how, you know, somebody has to go and pitch this. Don't do it for anything. Do it for two causes. You are serving your core audience, which is the voting population. Economy would automatically start growing. More people would get employed. And this would not dent your fiscal deficit at all. So don't worry about the balance sheet of it. But the 6.5 lakh crores of the excess liquidity, which is parked into, you know, non-productive asset today, even if you bring 2 lakh crore of that back to the economy, we will grow by 300 basis points higher than what we are growing right now.
In fact, Mr. Nath, I really like the whole asymmetric payoff that you actually presented in terms of how it's actually not a loss at all, but the gain, there is a significant upside. And that's something definitely in terms of, you know, an ask and the whole credit guarantee digital structure through the digital structure that you presented, it's a very effective way of kind of supporting the segment as well. So, you know, definitely a great suggestion input. And as you rightly said, also, it's not just about admitting, but it's also about actually taking it at different forums, talking about it and pushing the agenda as well. So definitely.
हमारा तो ये कोई सुनता नहीं है जीती भारत for vibrant India. You should go and pitch this to the government here. So my article is in public domain. I'll send it to you as well.
Correct, Vivek. You know, speaking of taking this forward, another thing, you know, forget, just think of it as taxpayers having this discussion. If you look at the amount all of us have to innovate, for the last 20 years, 25 years, we've been trying to innovate at assessing what a borrower earns. You know, you plug into 5 systems, you do so many things to try and understand what does a small business earn, right? Now, you know, speaking, you know, since Sachin mentioned, right, that we put it out there. One of the things that we had put a while ago in saying that every incentive is out there to have you remain small. There is no incentive for you to be a taxpayer. There is no incentive for you to become large.
I agree.
So they started this great initiative, right? We get these certificates in contributing to nation building. The color of the certificate changes depending on how much tax you pay. I'd actually made the suggestion and had a couple of conversations. Back it up start giving preference to taxpayers, right? For example, you run a passport service. When you come into immigration, we are a country where you spend so much time innovating, trying to figure out how much this guy earns. The guy is not a, he's barely a taxpayer, but drives a 50 lakh car. Then you have some, you know, then you build algos to saying we'll find fraud alerts type of systems to try and correlate the two. We're a prestige driven economy country. We're a culture where, you know, the wedding costs and IT returns don't sink. Just build that in. When you've got a preferred red carpet line at immigration, and I, you know, this is a simplistic example, but just imagine how many opportunities are there to pay it forward. That encourages you to, you know, so RERA was a move in that direction. DMON attempted that. Where's the upside for the taxpayer? Bring it in, bring it front and center. Wear it with pride that, you know, I've, guys do it at airports all the time, right? What is the grade of your card gets you somewhere else, some platinum. Get platinum taxpayer thing going. Watch how prestige kicks in and there's a trade-off. Give them some benefits. You know, fundamentally, it's the only business where your highest paying customer is the worst treated in every, almost every service that you apply for. Nothing is preferential, no matter you know, what the color of your certificate is. So build it in front and center, and then we'll all have to innovate much less trying to estimate the guy's income and actually start offering services.
Oh, completely agree in terms of how incentivizing the right elements will in terms of really drive the right results. I mean, everybody knows that, if you want to encourage performance, you've got to measure it in the right way. And there is nothing better than kind of incentivizing to produce the right amount of results. Definitely in terms of agree with that. And in fact, the, you know, one of the common things, and this is something that, you know, in terms of personally I've experienced that, given that we represent with the regulators on different occasions on the digital lending. So in fact, have been representing the lending side right from a peer-to-peer play. I mean, we went with an intent to help in terms of write the guidelines, but unfortunately the peer-to-peer lending 10 lakh limit came in. We had not suggested that, but that kind of came in. And one common, comeback or response that we get from the regulators, you know, conduct risk is a big worry and a concern that we have. And we just want to ensure that the ecosystem is kind of protected and the customers are taken care of. Standard sort of a response and a feedback. And because, you know, this regularly comes up as a point, and I do know that each one of your businesses, customer experience is the top priority. And in terms of, you know, managing customer lifecycle and ensuring, because as Rajesh, you also mentioned in terms of, that customers from that standpoint, data collaboration, everything that needs to come in. But the most important piece is the fact that from a customer perspective, you have to ensure that you retain it. Now, from a customer lifecycle management standpoint, and to ensure conduct risk is on the lower side, and also to give a certain assurance to the regulator, you know, what are some of the things that you believe would kind of help assuage this concern that the regulator has been having? I mean, based on some conversations that I've had, and I'm sure, you know, some of you must have had as well. But what do you think are some of the initiatives that kind of help address that? And, you know, what is it that you're seeing, you know, some insights, thought on that?
Vivek, if it's okay with you and the panelists, I actually had a hard stop at 3:30 because I have to get elsewhere.
Sure.
I'll move on this question, and if it's okay with you all, then I shall say bye for today, but I will connect back with all of you.
Definitely.
Thank you. So I'll just take a minute on this. On conduct risk, I think some discussions with the banker fraternity, I know there's been a lot of attention around conduct risk. So a lot of discussions with the banker fraternity and some with the, I think the way I'm saying it, it's coming down to two, three areas. I think first and foremost is establishing standards. So while all organizations have good code of conduct, et cetera, right? For certain departments, given the kind of sales, et cetera, that happens, right? We have to revisit these age old code of conducts, which employees all sign once a year, blah, blah. We have to redo that whole training part. Retail lending has grown by leaps and bounds over the years. there are thousands of employees across the country, etc., associates, partners, vendors. They come from different backgrounds, all values, ethics, integrity. How do you? So A, that whole process of setting the standards has to be reset. Then training internally also has to change. All those very boring, big fat documents that you're supposed to sign, etc., has to change. There has to be a lot more regular reinforcement and make it interesting, because beyond a point, we know big fat documents, nobody's reading before they sign, right? Those kind of changes there. And then likewise, even with consumers on the other side, how do we work the awareness? Because conduct, the very word, it's human behavior. All aspects about human behavior can be defined in two words. What is expected of you and what did you do? In many ways, be it culture, religion, everywhere, it's about those definitions. And then when we talk about this digital world and all kinds of new innovation, cross-sell, all that the industry is aiming to do, right? Obviously, it's going to be confusing for the customer. But if the solution to that is another 10-page document that somebody has to sign, it's not going to work. So in our world where we talk so much about UI, UX, pop-ups, notifications, blah, blah, how do we do this differently to ensure the right conduct really is the focus? And last but not the least, today we have this great advantage of this bhayankar digitalization that we're talking about everywhere. How are we bringing those things to step up and improve conduct risk? I just thought I'd add that much. If it's okay with you all, I'm afraid I have to run, but thank you all very much. And I'll look back, Vivek. Thank you and all of you. Good day.
So for the other panel members, in terms of your inputs, your thoughts in terms of how do you see that?
Sure, let me talk about it. Vivek, actually the second question around regulatory framework and conduct risk are actually not independent of each other, right? Let me at the outset say that maybe amongst other panelists, I feel that the Indian regulators, policymakers are far, far more progressive than I follow a lot of the other global macros. I genuinely believe that there is a lot more progressive thinking in an Indian system than otherwise. From a regulatory perspective, I'm sorry, going back to the previous question, a couple of points and then I'll come to that. From a regulatory perspective, I think what the ecosystem tries to do and the regulator tries to do is try to create the right framework from an understanding and therefore solution perspective, right? Whether it's account aggregator, whether it's PCR, et cetera, where there is a gap in the way the regulations get implemented, and that's basically the last mile, right? I don't think there is a very effective platform in which, and the stakeholder, whether it's the banks or the fintechs, very, very different priorities, right? Very, very different way of thinking. How do you think about digitization? What it means for their individual businesses, right? You're at one level, you may have an HDFC bank, lakhs of crores of market valuation, and digital will take its own time. You have a fintech, which is maybe hundreds or thousands of crores are valued, and therefore it makes bringing all of the stakeholders together, and therefore looking at the last mile implementation of regulation is where I think things get broken in India. And it's not just one aspect. Let's take Aadhaar and KYC, right? It's what, 10 years old, right? A 10, 12 year old technology. But even today, for a fintech to completely, entirely make use of such a fantastic digital infrastructure is not as seamless as it is for the bank, right? And look at account aggregator, and Rajesh alluded to that, still a lot of lack of clarity. What are the use cases? Who can use, under what circumstances, et cetera? And therefore, there is a little bit of gap, and I think it's maybe pace as much as it's gap in terms of last mile accessibility for different stakeholders in the digital ecosystem, right? And there, I think there needs to be two things. One, the platform where all of them interact and come to a common decision needs to be created. I think B, there has to be a perspective of taking some regulatory leaps and learning from it rather than coming to a perfect solution. And this is where I'll come to the second point, which is on conduct risk, right? See, when it comes to players like us, we are in the micro-lending space, digital micro-lending space. The way we think about conduct risk is very customer and borrower front. We feel that if we do some kind of a conduct risk that turns away a customer, customer genuinely has a very, very open canvas to compare, contrast, and therefore pick and choose the right partner. If you have a conduct risk, you will lose the customer eventually. But the conduct risk, what it does is, it, once you keep the customer aside, you're working on the regulatory arbitrage here. If the regulations are not clear, particularly on the last mile, what conduct risk is a manifestation of my interpretation of regulation versus someone else's interpretation of regulation, right? And therefore, that part of the conduct risk is coming from, you know, again, coming back to the last mile thing. I personally feel that the best way to solve for conduct risk is to create customer awareness. I think that is something that the regulator can take steps in terms of what is the consent architecture, what should the customer be aware of, putting the right capital behind making the customer aware. I think if that push comes, the most learned borrower will ensure that the conduct risk goes away rather than looking at, you know, the market players to, you know, change some things or et cetera, et cetera. That's my perspective.
So the you know, Krishna, you mentioned a really interesting thing on the whole consent architecture piece, because that kind of, you know, the whole process of consent will kind of take away the whole element of misunderstanding, which is, you know, the core you know, from a conduct risk standpoint.
As a fintech player, I don't even know which law to look at to even understand what is a consent architecture. I mean, there's just so many mishmashes of, so I look to Google more than I look to law, right? So,
there's
definitely
lack
of clarity around.
No, definitely. That's interesting. So, you know, in terms of, in the interest of time, you know, couple of summarizations as I kind of see from a discussion standpoint. In fact, the beautiful part of actually being a part of this panel is that someone as limited in knowledge as me can actually get to be a part of it and actually learn as a part of the exercise. I made some really interesting points as a part of our conversation. I would, you know, just for the benefit of our audience as well, I would like to kind of summarize some of the interesting points that, you know, that everyone kind of put on the table. You know, Mr. Nath brought in some really interesting perspectives in terms of, you know, the Oxford example that I kind of take away with in terms of how the trust deficit is the real core issue. And, you know, and probably it should not be the direction of the wind that should determine in terms of how a growth should be supported or not, but it should be more structural. So that is a really interesting piece. And the whole cycle of capital also, that in terms of, you mentioned one thing definitely in terms of key takeaway is the whole credit guarantee through digital structure. You know, the whole credit enhancements, the credit guarantee schemes, I think these are underutilized. They exist as a tool, but they are not applied in the right manner. And I think, you know, that's a great suggestion that, you know, in terms of, you know, came from there. Rajesh, of course, had to leave early, but, you know, interesting piece that realistically he brought about was that collaboration is not a choice. You know, it potentially damages the industry. It results in a fragmentation. And that will kind of help crash the unit economics as well. And that's something that I really, in terms of light from that standpoint. Sumit made a very interesting point in terms of how operational costs have been reduced and barriers to entry, you know, no longer are very, very low. And that means technically in terms of having more competition, more efficiency. And that's something that in terms of, you know, from a key takeaway standpoint, I really, in terms of like that. You know, Manish made a really interesting point in terms of how, you know, what as a housing loan or home loan business, you know, which is a commoditized business, how can you exactly in terms of look at actually addressing the root cause of the problem and offer the whole experience? Because the home buying experience is by far the biggest, you know, in the dream list for all the people in the country, and the structure your own EMI, you know, very simplistic, but in terms of getting back to basics and in terms of kind of helping that and actually building in operational efficiency across the whole value chain. So, you know, working from home versus disbursing from home, you know, to make it equal. When it started off, it wasn't, but to actually make it equal and bring it there. So that's a really interesting piece that in terms of I saw coming, and obviously in terms of incentivization in terms of actually pushing the right incentives, and the taxpayer was a great example. And in terms of pushing that, I mean, in my own limited way, I would try to pick that up and kind of also drive it in my own small way. You know, Krishan brought in a really interesting perspective in terms of what are the four layers from a business standpoint, and how exactly we have been kind of looking at an inclusive Bharat, and how that's been the focus, and how from a conduct risk standpoint, it is about simplifying the asks rather than complicating it, because the objective is to achieve the end result. These are some really, really interesting pieces personally in terms of from my standpoint that I really learned as a part of being a part of this discussion. Thank you so much for being a part of this panel, and thank you so much for letting me moderate this session. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.